Hey there, listeners. This is Classical Classroom Editor Mark DiClaudio. Just a warning about this week's episode. If you are easily offended by terrible-sounding Italian pronunciation, A, we don't blame you, and B, preparati, which is rough Italian for brace yourselves. It's coming anyway. As it turns out, pronouncing anything in Italian is not a gift that your host Dacia or obviously I possess. However, this week's guest, violist Simone Gramaglia, is darn good at it. He's also great at explaining Beethoven's development as a composer. So, class, this is going to be one of those episodes you're going to want to get out your crayons and your pencils and get ready. If you enjoy getting your learn on with Classical Classroom, please go to the iTunes and rate and review us. The more popular you make us, the further this kind of knowledge spreads. Also, it makes us smile to see your reviews. Now, on with the show, huh?
My name is Dacia Clay. I'm the audio librarian here at Classical 91.7. While I'm a real librarian, I have a deep, dark
secret.
I know very little about classical music. I grew up listening to rock. And I know something about jazz. But when it comes to classical... But I really want to learn. So, every week on this show, a classical music expert will give me a piece of classical music they think I should know, and then we'll discuss it. Come learn with me in the Classical Classroom. Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Classical Classroom. I'm Dacia Clay, and here with me today is Simone Gramaglia. I'm going to butcher your name. Simone Gramaglia. That is my Perfecto. Best Italian accent.
Fantastic. It's amazing. You are a perfect Italian.
So he is a violist of Quartetto di Cremona. He formed the group in 2000, and he's talking to us all the way from Baliasco, Italy. He regularly performs with various orchestras and musicians. His concerts have been broadcast worldwide on networks like the BBC and WQXR, and Quartetto di Cremona has a new CD, Beethoven Complete String Quartets. This is actually volume 5, it looks like. Is that right?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Well, welcome to the show. Welcome to the Classical Classroom.
Oh, thank you very much, Dacia. It's a pleasure to be here and to talk to you and to your listeners.
Well, I am hoping that today you can teach me a little bit about the music that's on your CD, which kind of spans Beethoven's development as a composer. And what I was interested in when I first saw your CD is that there's a little bit in the description about the fact that Beethoven didn't actually compose that much for strings initially, just for string quintets specifically. Is that right?
Yeah, you're right. I mean, he was very focused on string quartets, and at the end, compared to other composers of his time, he didn't compose so much. I mean, if you think Mozart composed 23 string quartets, and Haydn, I mean, what a number! I think more than 70. Mm-hmm. So Beethoven just 16, but I think that the greatness of Beethoven was that he took the classical style, this way of composing. I mean, the rules of this way to write music, and he opened the doors to the future. I mean, and he was the only one to do it, because I mean, Mozart was great. I mean, Mozart's string quartets are unbelievable. I mean, without Mozart's string quartets, we couldn't have the Beethoven ones. Yeah. And of course, without Haydn's string quartets, we couldn't have Mozart's string quartets. But then Beethoven was able to really to open the door to the future, to the romantic style and to everything. Because so the development of this man has been extremely big, because he started, let's say, following the rules, just trying to show that he was a good composer, that he was able to write music for string quartets, and that he was able to do it in the right way, respecting the rules. Mm-hmm. And then arriving to Opus 59, I mean, number one, where he already changes everything. And there was an Italian violinist, very famous at the time of Beethoven, looking at the score of the first violin, telling him, "But maestro, this is too difficult for your contemporary to play this music. Why did you write something so difficult?" And Beethoven already answered, "I didn't write this music for the person, the people of my time. This is the music for the future. Ooh. And you know, and then yeah. he arrived to opus 127, and then 131. 131, it is a visionary string quartet. It was the Beethoven loved this quartet particularly. And you start from the first bar, and you stop 40 minutes later without breaks, no movements.
Oh my God!
And you have to go to Schoenberg to find another work like this. So I mean, and it was Beethoven, and then opus 130 with the Great Fugue. And there is a document of the time where, you know, nowadays when we perform, we use not to upload between the movements. But mm-hmm. at Beethoven's time, it was normal. So right. I was reading this a few months ago. After the first movement of 130, people were so happy. After every movement, I mean, since the cavatina, they were so happy. Then the Great Fugue arrived, and they performed, and no applause, nothing. Uh-huh. People was shocked. By this movement.
Really?
And the editor, and the editor told to Beethoven, please, man, it's a bit difficult this moment. So let's say that you will write another finale for this quartet, more simple, more understandable, and we will decide that the Great Fugue, we will come an opus by itself, opus 133, that for many years wasn't played. So you can imagine how visionary was this man. And yeah. the Great Fugue can be more contemporary even nowadays than a lot of contemporary music. So, I mean, I think that Beethoven music and his development during his years is kind of something of unique. I mean, if you think to Shostakovich, I mean, Shostakovich wrote, I think, 17 or 16, I mean, something like that. I don't remember exactly. But anyway, if you listen to the first one and the last one, you can find a kind of continuity in the style. Mm-hmm. But in Beethoven, there are some moments in the late quartets where you really don't know what he was doing.
Well, let's go back. This has been a great overview of kind of all of his music and all of his periods. But let's go back to the beginning when he was sort of a rule follower, as you said, and he was just kind of trying to write music that you know fit his time. And what's a good example of this music? Let's give it a listen.
I think that if you listen to the opus 16, you really understand. I mean, it could be the beginning. It could be a Haydn string quartet. It starts with tom, trium, pim, pam, pam, pa, with the first violin, and then the cello, trium, pom, pim, pom, pira. This is really something that is connected with Haydn, with the classical style music.
Yeah.
And of course you have first part, then you have the repeat, then you have the development, then you have the ripresa. I mean, the classical, you know, the classical shape of a classical string quartet. Really try to respect all the rules of writing music of the classical styles, then he starts to lose this, let's say, discipline in about the classical styles. And then we can listen this when we arrive at the opus 59, and then opus 74, and even more in opus 95.
Okay, so is this sort of his middle period, the opus 95?
Middle period. It's the last work of the middle period.
Okay.
And it's and here probably something changed, something very big changed in his life, because in opus 95 everything changed, because first of all, in the first movement is very short. There is no there are no repetitions, and he asked for a very furious tempo. Uh-huh. And the theme is just pam 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 pam. You know, it's crazy. I mean, there is not we can't say that there is a real development, because there are many things that come, then they go, and then a new thing, and then this new element. I mean, it's crazy.
Oh, I see what you're talking about.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, the playing sort of furiously.
and then different again. Here, Beethoven, I think, put a point to change everything and then to arrive finally to the late string quartets. With this kind of
isn't that something that kind of came to mark Beethoven's style, was that sort of furious, like, that's when you think of Beethoven, you think of him just, you know, a sort of bombastic, you know. And so that's a great example. And so that was at the end of his middle period, where you're saying something really changed for him. Do we know anything? Do you know anything about what happened in his life that might have had some sort of creative effect on him?
Sure. First of all, we have to say that the big illness that Beethoven had, I mean, he became deaf at the end of his life. I think that this big illness changed a lot his way to think and to feel the music, because usually every one of us thinks something, feels something inside, but then we try it playing. Mm-hmm. I mean, if I am a composer, I play what I think. You know, it's very difficult. It's unusual just to think something and just to write it without trying it. But at the end of his life, Beethoven couldn't do this.
Right, he couldn't test it out. Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So he was just thinking to the music. This is one reason, because many times he wrote so fast tempos, you know, that metronome marks by Beethoven are always furious, extremely fast.
Yeah.
One of the reasons could be that he wasn't able to listen anymore. So he was just thinking, listening to inside to the music. So it was kind of absolute music, you know, without anything, just something very pure. In a way, it's this music, it sounds like this, because it seems that it can sound like some Bach music. That, you know, if you think to the Art of the Fugue, it's written for four voices.
Yeah.
And it could be string quartet, it could be four pianos, it could be, you know, four voices.
Mm-hmm.
And because it's totally pure, it's totally in the air. And also the Beethoven's music is a little bit like that, particularly the late quartets. If you go on the Opus 18, it's not like that. It's very different.
Yeah, let's talk about the late period. Like what marks his late period? What's distinctive about it? I mean, I know you said that he essentially just stopped abiding by any rules whatsoever and just had completely sort of deconstructed those rules that he had mastered to begin with. How does that sound, though?
Well, you know, I mean, at the end of his life, the late period, Beethoven, first of all, was really deaf. So he didn't like to meet people, to communicate with people. He was writing on the paper, what he wanted to say, and people had to write to him just to communicate. So these things, I think, changed a lot his mind. Then he was very angry. With the world. I think that there is a letter by Beethoven. One of his letters is very, it explains many things, because he received some wrong things from the world, you know, and he was angry with the world, because the world didn't understand his talent, his messages.
The world didn't understand what he was trying to say, essentially.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
And this was something that for Beethoven was extremely bad. So he wrote that he was sure that in the future people would have understood his music. So he was thinking then to write music not for people of his time, but for people of the future, you know. And this is, I think that this, plus the deafness, plus the fact that he was extremely alone, changed his mind, and he wrote what he wrote, and I mean, complete masterpieces that, in a way, weren't loved at his time.
So he was basically the David Bowie of his day.
Yeah, exactly. I agree.
He's a man from the future. Well, let's hear an example of this late period music. What should we listen to?
I would play, for example, the last movement of the Opus 132.
Okay. All right.
If you have it.
Yeah, we've got that. It sounds like there's, and maybe I'm just reading this into it because I know what was going on in his life, like there's a little bit more sort of darkness in his music. Maybe it's just more depth, I don't know.
Yeah, sure. And it's amazing because this beginning could be Brahms, you know?
Mm-hmm.
It could be totally be a string quartet by Brahms,
yeah.
For example.
Brahms, who is known for the sort of personal emotion in his music, right?
Exactly. Yeah. And if you think to this, and this beginning with the other instruments that do a small crescendo every bar, I mean, this could be really a romantic string quartet, and it's amazing because it's Beethoven, you know.
Yeah. And, how long did Brahms come after him, like the?
A few years later, because okay. Brahms, I would like to check exactly when he wrote his first string quartet, but probably it's not more than 20 years or something like that after Beethoven. And we have Schubert. I mean, Schubert, you know that Schubert loved Beethoven, mm-hmm. and he was at the funeral, the Beethoven's funeral. Mm-hmm. Schubert was there. So, crying a lot, he wrote in his letter, Beethoven was a genius. We lost one of probably the bigger genius in the world. I mean, there was a great connection between all these guys, and mm-hmm. and you can Beethoven really made the difference. Brahms' music, or you can find something in Schubert, or for example Shostakovich. Just going to the 20th century, Shostakovich mm-hmm. loved Beethoven, was passionate by Beethoven, and for example, in the Viola Sonata mm-hmm. By Shostakovich, the last movement, there is a quotation by Moonlight Sonata. Mm-hmm. The viola plays tam pa pam, and pianoforte pam, and the piano tam pam 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 pam. So it's amazing. Beethoven really changed everything. I'm sure about that. And he died in 1827. So 6 years later, Brahms was born.
So Beethoven really tapped into something that was timeless. And anticipated what was to come in music.
Yeah, wow. Absolutely. I mean,
that's amazing.
It's amazing. If you think to this, it's really amazing because we are used nowadays to listen to Beethoven, to listen to music, to listen to Mozart. Mm-hmm. I mean, for us, it's quite everything is quite normal. But and it's okay because I mean we are used to. We have a lot of CDs, a lot of music, but we should think to something that. In a simple way, maybe, but just to make an example, changed our life completely. For mm-hmm. example, let's think to the iPhone or to the iPad mm-hmm. or to the iPod, for example.
Yeah.
I mean, we were used to listen to music, with these very old machines, big machines. We didn't know about now. Then someone arrived and changed everything in the whole world because he invented a little machine and he decided that music could be on the air, just on the cables, on computers, it's something like that. And Beethoven changed everything. I mean, people were not used at his time to these big changes. It's why he wasn't understood.
Yeah. So he had as big of an impact on music as some development like the iPod. That's kind of incredible to think of. Wow.
Yeah, it's a simple. I mean, maybe it's not my best example, but it's in a way it's like that. I mean, nowadays we live for technology, and it's like, it's a kind of big change like this, yeah.
But it was,
unfortunately,
it was,
Beethoven was less lucky than Apple, you know.
He was less lucky.
Yeah, because Apple had a great success, Beethoven, unfortunately not.
I'm gonna bet that Beethoven's gonna be around with us for longer than the iPod.
Exactly.
Well,
Simone, that's for sure.
Simone, it has been awesome to talk to you. This has been really, really fun.
Thank you very much. And I mean, it was a pleasure to me to talk to you. Thank you very much. And I hope to see Houston once.
Yes, if you do, let us know if you're coming to town and we'll talk again.
Bye-bye, Dasha. Thank you very much.
All right, that does it for this episode of Classical Classroom. For more Classroom, go to houstonpublicmedia.org/classroom. Follow us all over the internet, including Twitter, Tumblr, our extensive YouTube channel. Rate, review us, and subscribe to us on iTunes. And you can email me at dclay@houstonpublicmedia.org. Thanks today to audio producer Todd La Dolce Todda Hulslander for twiddling knobs. Thanks to editor Mark DiClaudio for his piercing Fellini-esque eyes. Thanks to Simone Gramaglia for being here today and not getting mad at me for my terrible Italian accent. Thanks to me for saying words. But most of all, grazie to you for listening. We'll catch you next time.